Hello. We're coming to you from the Treasure Coast of Florida. Welcome to the St. Lucie County Environmental Resources Department's virtual guided nature program series. So what exactly is an air plant? And is epiphyte the same thing? An air plant and an epiphyte are essentially the same thing. One is the common name, that being air plant, and epiphyte is the more technical scientific name, but they're really the same thing. Air plants are arboreal. It means that they grow up in the air, typically on other vegetation like trees, while terrestrial plants are growing in the soil or sand, or they're affixed to rocks. So that's what separates them. Air plants have evolved to be able to live up high. They don't need soil, and they don't impair or damage the plant on which they grow. There are, on the Treasure Coast here in St. Lucie County, some very interesting types of air plants that we'd like to introduce to you. And there's different families or taxonomy groups that we want to introduce to you as well. The first one is a bromeliad. And there's several different types of bromeliads, different species of them, but there's four general groupings or forms that we see here. The first one is the Spanish moss. Spanish moss is what I would call a draping bromeliad because it drapes over branches of trees and onto boughs or large branches and hangs down. It's a beautiful bromeliad too, and it is essentially a harmless resident of your tree. Many people have gotten the idea, and mistakenly so, unfortunately, that this is a parasitic plant that harms the trees. And I'd like to clarify that in no way is it a parasitic plant at all. In fact, it evolved together naturally with the trees and other vegetation of Florida, as have all the other epiphytes, to live together in groups and communities. This particular plant, as it hangs down and drapes, is home to many, many different organisms, its shelter, and it provides nesting space for at least two species of native birds, those being the northern parula and the Baltimore oriole. So if Spanish moss is removed from the environment, then at least two species of birds will not be able to reproduce successfully here in Florida. The Spanish moss also has insects in it, and the birds, while they're nesting, can climb through the Spanish moss and glean some of those insects. It has microbes on it as well, of course. But one misconception that folks have is that chiggers are living in the draping Spanish moss, and that's not really true. When Spanish moss is draping from the tree, it's too high for the little insects to climb up in it. Rather, when Spanish moss has sloughed off and is now on the ground, that's when chiggers, if they're present in that area, will climb into the Spanish moss. And then once you pick it up, you'll be exposed to them. So it only has it when it's on the ground. Otherwise, it's got small little insects in it that the birds are eating for you and that the birds are happy to do so as they're nesting and they're taking shelter. So this is a draping epiphyte or air plant, and that's one of the types of bromeliads. Another type of bromeliad is the ball moss, and if you look carefully, the ball moss essentially looks like a balled up Spanish moss, but it is a little bit different. It's not a draping bromeliad, it's affixed to this tree twig. Now, it has a special rooting system. It's very small, but it's very strong, and it allows the plant to stay rooted onto the exterior of the tree bark. It doesn't harm the tree at all. It stays in place. It gleans, as do all air plants or epiphytes, what it needs from the air. That means nutrients, moisture. It is able to do photosynthesis because it's high up and it likes to be where the sunlight is. And so all the nutrients and everything that it needs is passed to it from the air and onto the plant. The Spanish moss and some of the air plants may benefit a little bit from things like bird droppings and other things which will give them nutrients, because they can absorb these nutrients, the water and things from the air, directly through their foliage. So the ball moss here, as you can see, this one was fertilized. It's flower from last season, and it's actually gone to seed, and the seeds have already dispersed. So this one has successfully reproduced. And so the ball moss, you'll see, looks very, very much similar to the draping Spanish moss. Another type of bromeliad air plant is that one that we put in the group of the wild pine, and you can guess why we call it that. This looks just like someone took a bunch of pine needles and stuck them right onto a little branch. And each one of these is an individual piece of foliage or a leaf, and they look rounded just like a pine needle. So this is the perfect way to think of them and to group them into a type that you can remember easily. So the wild pine type of bromeliad. It too also gets its air, water, and nutrients from the air and the sunshine. It also affixes to the branch, just like the ball moss does. And it does not harm the tree either. Next to this is a group that we tend to think of as a tank bromeliad. And the reason we call it that is you will notice that the leaves have formed like a little blade, and they've got curvature. And down in there, right in here, water can drip down from the rain and form little pockets or little tanks. So this is another basic type of grouping. When we look at bromeliads, we can think of them. So we have a draping kind, we have one that looks like balled up moss, we have one that looks like wild pine needles, and now we have something called a tank bromeliad, which collects water here in its pockets. Here is a very large one. You'll notice the rooting structures here, which help it hold on to the exterior bark. This one was unfortunately dislodged in strong wind and it fell to the ground, but we found it and were able to put it back into an area with bark and soil and allow it to live on. You can relocate them at times and put them back up into trees to help them continue to live. This one has a most beautiful flower and it's coming to the end of its bloom cycle. These blooms were yellowish purple, and if they were properly pollinated, then this plant will produce seeds, and we'll see seed pods shortly. But you'll notice this looks like a beautiful fire spike. This lovely red color is just beautiful and scenic, and it makes for the best photographs. Here you can see the principle of the curvature of the foliage that allows the water to run down and into the center, into the core, to form those little pockets or tanks. So epiphytes, or air plants, we've covered one main group, and that would be the bromeliads. Another group is that of lichens and mosses. Here we have curly birch, which is this. Curly birch is a fungus and an algae, as all lichens are. And this really wonderful particular type of plant is a formation of algae and lichen together, where the lichen gives it structure and the ability to root itself onto a substrate like bark, and the algae helps it provide some photosynthesis and a few other nutrients while they work together to form this particular organism. This one is called beard moss, and it's these structures right here, these hairy little structures. And the beard moss also is a lichen. Now, it's not true that lichens cause the decline of a plant, such as a tree or a shrub. They might begin to inhabit bare spots and inhabit a tree that's already weakened and is near the end of its life. But the lichen themselves do not cause death, weakness, or harm to any tree that they inhabit. They're a natural part of the ecosystem and a natural part of the arboreal plant communities. Another category after bromeliads and lichens and mosses would be ferns. And here we have the resurrection fern. This fern was exposed to rainwater, and so it's opened up and unfurled and come out of stasis. You'll notice that on the back of this fern, it has something called sori. These sori, or spores, are what the plant uses to reproduce in time when they've matured and they're ready to be released. Here is a very young frond of the fern. And this one is a older version of it. When the fern is asleep and it's in stasis, waiting to unfurl, it curls up and looks brown, very much like this. And we'll see more of them up on the trees soon. And as soon as the rain begins to fall, they uncurl just like a hand and go from brown back to green. So they, hence they got their nickname, the resurrection fern. I've saved the best for last because often most people really love this particular category of epiphyte the most. And that would be the orchid. So we have bromeliads, lichens and mosses, ferns, and orchids. This is a butterfly orchid, and it's native here, and it's found in St. Lucie County. When it blooms around late May and early June. The plant overall, essentially, this part has already bloomed and lived its life and died, but this part is alive and well, and it will probably reproduce and give us flowers very soon. You'll notice the rooting structures that the orchid uses. This is very typical of arboreal orchids. And here is the foliage. And remember that like other air plants, it gets all its sustenance from the air and the rainwater and the sun. So air plants are a really unique group of plants. They have some abilities that the terrestrial plants growing down the ground don't have, and that they have changed and evolved and modified over time so that they could learn to live up in the air and they could be extraordinarily efficient to cover a niche, cover a location, and form a new community where there was space and there was availability of resources, meaning sunlight, water, air. So air plants are very, very unusual and different. And here in the Treasure Coast, we have quite a variety of them to see, and we'll see more shortly. Recall that bromeliads, as one of the more popular and well-known epiphytes or air plants, this is a tank bromeliad. This particular tank bromeliad has reproduced and it's actually gone to seed. You'll notice that the flowers have opened, and here it's produced its seeds. So you may be wondering, because this tree branch has fallen and it's on the ground, how does the bromeliad actually reproduce? Remember that the bromeliad is up in a tree and that this fallen branch is just an accessible example for us, because this is how it really happens. Here we have an example of various lichens and mosses. This beautiful, almost bubblegum pink is called a red carpet moss, but it's actually a lichen. So red carpet lichen would actually be its real name. It is naturally this color. There isn't any sort of treatment or anything that's been done to it to alter it. It grows this color naturally. And it can vary from a pale salmon to a bright, brilliant fuchsia pink, as you see here before you. You'll also notice there are other types of lichens here. A wild pine bromeliad on this side. And as we move over here and take another look, we can actually see a close-up of that beautiful red carpet lichen. In mosses and lichens, which is one of our types of arboreal plants, known as air plant and epiphyte, we have mosses. And so these mosses tend to grow up on the outside of tree barks. They seem to have a preference for palm trees and oaks, but you can find them on other trees. And here too are some resident ferns. And Spanish moss, which again is a bromeliad, not a moss. One of the other categories of air plants is, of course, the fern. Now, remember that we saw a resurrection fern earlier when we were discussing introduction to the air plants. These resurrection ferns are in stasis. They're waiting until the next rainfall comes. When they're in stasis, they curl up and appear dead, but they're not dead. They're just resting. Recall that when the rains come, they will unfurl and show their beautiful green foliage once again. Another type of fern, and one that has an unusual name and appearance, is the shoestring fern. Many people mistake it for a type of grass, and we often get many questions about, how did that grass get up on that palm tree? Well, it's actually not a grass at all, but a very specialized type of arboreal fern. It too is an air plant. Another member of the fern family here in Sweetwater Hammock is the golden polypoidy fern. You can see on the underside of its foliage small dots. Those sori, or spores, or what will release to help the plant reproduce when it's time. Here we have, right overhead on what appears to be a water oak, we have an entire colony of the wild pine-like bromeliads. Look at how many plants are festooning and growing in close proximity to each other. We call this festooned, or festooning of a tree. This is normal and natural. This is exactly how the trees and the epiphytes, or air plants, evolved to live together in communities. You can help preserve these botanical natural treasures by promoting good stewardship through leading by example. Do not remove any wild plants, including air plants, from any public lands. Protect Florida's native plant communities by allowing adult air plants to remain intact on trees and shrubs in your yard and in communally managed property. Allowing young plants to grow and thrive where they have attached, and never subjecting air plants to herbicides or toxins. Sweetwater Hammock Preserve offers 7 acres of lush riparian hammock forest, replete with air plant communities overhead, and a beautiful view of the St. Lucie River on a scenic, easy-to-navigate quarter-mile trail. For more information about this and other sites managed by the St. Lucie County Environmental Resources Department, contact us by phone or visit our website. Thank you for joining us at Sweetwater Hammock Preserve, and be sure to visit all our beautiful preserves today. None of the plants were harmed in the making of this production. What do we mean by that? All the plants which appeared in today's production were naturally dislodged in my backyard because of natural events like wind and rain. And after this production, we returned them to continue on with their lives, secured with a little help to the trees.